Well, would you look at that? Just been chatting away for 3 whole minutes and there's no sound. Guys, let me know if you can hear me now. What I was saying was really interesting. There we go. Shane says, looks like what he was saying was really interesting. Well, you know what it is? What I was saying was really interesting. It's probably the most interesting thing I've ever said in my entire life. Said nobody ever. The cough button was pressed. Can you believe that? I was so happy with the jam that lo and behold, what happened? I left the cough button on. That's okay. Anyway, let's start that all again. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison, it is the Monday Guitar Show. Welcome, it's great to have you on board. If you're joining us for the first time, it's great to have you. If you are one of our returning, growing community of streamers, either on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel or the Lick Library YouTube channel, it is lovely to have you back. We heard your guitar for sure, said Winston Howard, but we can't hear your words. Probably for the best. Anyway, so going back to what we were talking about before. So today we are continuing a discussion on practice and all things practice related. So a couple of weeks ago, we discussed the three things that you must practice, because they're the only three things that you can practice. It was a bit of a clickbaity title, but you know, we had to get you here. And today is kind of no different, to be honest, but even still, we've got some good stuff here. Hopefully we're gonna equip you with three things that will enable you to better practice your physical technique on the guitar. Now, a few weeks ago, we discussed the three things that you must practice, which is physical technique, fretboard and musical theory and all that stuff, knowledge, and then repertoire and contribution. Last week we discussed the repertoire thing in our Growing Your Vocabulary stream. That is available on both YouTube channels on the replay if you want to go and check it out. If you're not subscribed to us already, hit the subscribe bell. It would be great to have you. Let me make sure I turn that cough button on and back off again. Anyway, today we're discussing the physical technique thing. Now don't worry if you're not a technique monster, if you're not a shreddy type guitar player, if that's not your bag, that's fine. This stuff is applicable for guitar players of all levels, of all styles, because we all need some kind of physical technique on the instrument. And our physical technique is what enables us to actually play the things that we want to play on the guitar, whether that's learning songs, whether that's improvising, whether it's writing songs, whether it's playing a band, whether it's whatever it is. You need some degree of physical technique to be able to play on the instrument. And the better your physical technique is, the more transparent it feels, the more easily you're going to be able to express yourself as a musician, which ultimately is our goal here. So today we're discussing technique. We've got three things for you. Hopefully by the end of the stream, you will have something that you'll be able to go away and implement in your practice sessions, which will help you grow your technique at an accelerated rate. And then we can stop talking about technique and get on to making music like the other instruments out there. For some reason, guitar players absolutely obsessed with technique. I think it's because it's quite a physically difficult instrument to play, but that's neither here nor there. Anyway, couple of quick shout-outs before we go, a little bit of housekeeping. If you're enjoying what we're doing today, don't forget you can go and check out our partners over at Lick Library and Guitar Interactive Magazine. You can go to licklibrary.com on the link down below, where you will find a whole host of tremendous guitar lessons, including, but not limited to, get this, drum roll, please, the new and improved GI Plus section over on Lick Library. Now, what we've got going on here is all of the lessons that were, still are, but for the time being at least, on the Guitar Interactive lesson portal, GI Plus. They've been ported over to Lick Library now, so they're available to all of our Lick Library members. There is over 100 lessons here. It's crazy. Now, a couple of courses I want to show you, a couple of mine you might find entertaining. This is a really good one for what we're discussing today. This is a course called Technique Hot Fixes. Now, what this basically is 10 lessons. A lot of our members over at GI Plus have had huge success with this, right? Basically, what we've done is we've taken 10 lessons that give you instant fixes to your technique. So you can go check this out among all of the other lessons that are available. We've got tech sessions, there's my Rory Gallagher tech session, we've got slide guitar stuff, Sam with some acoustic stuff, we've got some Motley Crue, some Eddie Van Halen, Tom Quayle talking about chord progressions, Andy Woods country guitar, Lewis Turner on jazz soloing, all of the legendary Michael Caswell lessons, they're all there. So that is all currently on licklibrary.com. If you are not a Lick Library member, but you are a GI Plus member, send yourself an email to this, right, real quick. So send yourself an email to this address. This is playersupport@licklibrary.com, and you will be told everything that you need to know about the switchover. If you're a Lick Library member, but not a GI Plus member, don't worry, you're automatically now a GI Plus member. You don't have to do anything. It's just been added to your membership. But GI Plus members who don't currently have a Lick Library subscription, don't worry, we're going to hook you up. So if you send an email here, we will give you the skinny on what's going on. That's my man, Stu Shields, who you guys all know already. He will sort you out. But yeah, really pleased to announce that's going live today. Got a couple of quick questions about this. We'll be answering your questions a little bit later on. Want to highlight this one, though. This is Block 18. Says, is that you doing a Rory Gallagher course, Nick? Be good if you can share why you rate him so much. Rory is... it was to celebrate the anniversary of Rory's passing, but I've always been an admirer of Rory Gallagher for his ferocity as a live player, more than anything else, to be honest. But there's a couple of things that he would do that I would absolutely love. I loved how effortlessly he would just grab a slide out of his pocket and start playing, and it was like, yeah, it's slide now. And then, for me, that was kind of revelation, because I always felt like slide you needed some kind of special other guitar for, that, you know, young me didn't want to take to the gig. But when I saw Rory just kind of pull one out of his pocket and start playing away, killer. There's a bit of that in the course too, so you want to learn some Rory Gallagher stuff, I've got a tech session on that subject, along with a bunch of others. There's like so many tech sessions in there, it's killer. Now anyway, we're going to take a quick look at the chat and say some hellos to everybody. We might not be able to get to everybody because we've got so many folks in the chat today. If you haven't done so already, give this video a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching it on, share it with your guitar playing friends. We'd love to get this to as many guitar players as we can. Marcin was of course first through the door at 20 minutes to 1 in C Central European time, which was wild. That is super, super early. First one in by a mile, followed by Response Audio. I hope everyone's having a great Monday. Looking forward to the stream later. I'm having a great Monday too. Larry Warren, also in the house. Lovely to see you. We're going to fast forward a wee little bit and see who's in the house now. Let's see. Timothy Appling is tuning in. It's spring break here. Just got back from the beach doing the daily bikini daily bikini check. That is terrible. Checking my new Gibson SG Supreme warmed up. Ooh, fabulous. Really, really, really nice. Great guitar. We love a bit of that. Kate Strange in the house says, hi, everybody. I hope we will all learn something tonight. So do I. I think you probably will. I think you're going to get some good stuff tonight. Found it really, really great so far. I don't see why we shouldn't do. Victor Zika is in the house. Helmet Strap is here. Daryl Queen is here. Justin Ray is tuning in. Kim Waller, the big boss, is here. Steve McDee is here. Cranker Tom is in the house with some questions about the GI Plus Lick Library stuff. Send an email to playersupport@licklibrary.com. We'll get you sorted out. Don't worry about that. We're going to hook you up. Timothy Appling, we've already said hello to. Deadman Dookie Van Dugason is here. Block 18 is here. We've already said hello. Frank is in the house. Who else do we have? Let's see. Cowcat is here. Jim Hofcrafter is here. Mika is in the house. Mark Crandall is tuning in. Steve McDee, we've already said hello to. Our friend John McGuigan is tuning in from France. Eddie Russell is here. Bonsoir, indeed. We've got a whole bunch of friends. James Fair is here. Let me know the sound is off. But we've got there in the end. They said I would find it funny if he was telling a really filthy joke. How do you know that I wasn't? It was a Schrodinger's joke, let's say. It was at once a filthy joke and not. And we'll never know. But anyway, the guitar works and the voice works now. So we got a question from Marcin. I want to know this too, right? From you guys, what do you guys play today? I've got my custom 24 in action, such a great axe, very light as well. My amp also wants to know what's going on. It's making whistling noises, does that sometimes? Very strange. I think it's something wrong with my wiring here, but I'll figure that all out. So we want to know what guitar you're playing. I am of course playing my Maybach Convair, which is my current number one, but let us know in the comments what guitar you are playing. Jason Perry says fire. The only fire is the tone coming out of the amp, but even still. Anyway, let's get into the meat of today's session, which is how you can practice to improve your physical technique. Let's get into it. So physical technique, why is it important? First of all, everything we play on the guitar requires some degree of physical technique. I want to perform a quick experiment for you real quick. We're going to abandon the whole business of playing anything super chopsy. Shush, amp, behave yourself. Silence. Got some really weird noises going on here, and I don't know why, but it's okay. We can run with this one. A perfectly fine noise. We'll run with that too. So, With amp noises aside, very, very unusual. I don't know what's going on there. I've been doing some reamping and maybe it's unhappy with me because I didn't use it for everything. So a little bit of experimentation. We have a backing track in the key of A minor today. We're going to be doing some expression stuff to begin with, just some expressive business, right? Because we don't tend to think about the feel thing as being a technique deal. We tend to think about it as something that, you know, well, you just feel it, man. Well, I'm going to hopefully dispel a bit of that today. So not that feel isn't important, of course it is, but let's do a lick together. We're going to take this lick in the key of A minor. We're going to use A minor pentatonic, and we're going to play the following. Really, really simple. What we're going to do here is we're going to take the 7th fret on the G string, bend it up, release it a teeny tiny bit, just the very smallest amount. And then we'll follow it up with 5 and 7 on the D string. So 5 on the G string, 7 on the D string. Now that we have that lick, let's try playing along with our backing track, and we'll get really comfy with this. You give me some variation of that lick. However you want to play it, you can play it for me. All right, now I'm going to play it again. I'm gonna go like this. You take a turn. One more time. I'm gonna go like this. You take a turn. So, probably not the most technically demanding lick in the world. I think we can agree. It's not a lick that is going to set the guitar-osphere on fire with its ferocious Paul Gilbert-esque wild picking nonsense. But. What we might see is we might see if we can play this without technique. And how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to do it the following way. This will apply to, I'm going to guess, 99% of you. If there are any ambidextrous guitar players out there, then feel free to show off in the comments. But we're going to do the following. We've taken the same lick. What I want you to do is, whichever orientation your guitar is, we're going to turn it the other way up, and we're going to play this way. Prepare for me to embarrass myself on stream. Okay. We're going to try and play the same lick, right? If anybody's tuning in right now, just to let you know, this is not the way I normally play the guitar, but we're going to do it together just to see how it works, right? Real quick, first of all, how do I even turn this thing on? That feels really uncomfortable. Okay, I'm gonna try the lick. Oh wow, that's hard. I'm on the wrong frets. Gross, horrible. You take a turn, the wrong way up. We're playing guitars upside down today. You take a turn. Let me know in the comments, have another go, if you can make anything musical out of that lick whatsoever. Now, comparison, flip it over the normal way. Easy. Piece of cake. The reason I bring this up is to highlight to you the importance of physical technique, even if we're not playing things that we think of as technique, if that makes sense. This is not really, we wouldn't call it a technique lick, but even with a fairly simple sounding lick, a lick that we might find fairly trivial to execute, it still requires a level of physical technique. Now, can any of you play that the upside down? I really, really hope at least one of you can, because I certainly can't, right? Maybe we have some Michelangelo Baitio style ambidextrous characters in the comments, who knows? We've got some great guitars in the comments though, that is for sure. Let's just take a quick look at some of those, because it'd be rude not to. We've got a PRS-SE hollow body, we've got a Jackson King V, we've got a Framer Strat Deluxe, a Parker Fly, a Gibson Explorer, we've got a Grover Jackson Dinky, very cool, P90 Revstar, fantastic guitars, we love them. A Fender Strat, a McCarty 594, I got one of them sitting right here, they're great guitars. Schecter Nick Johnson Diamond Series, very cool. CAR Strat 60th Anniversary, and an RK Fly Rig, did a review on one of those, they're great. Who else do we have? Daryl Queen says, don't have full-on PRS money, so I am playing a Santana SE. That is a full-on PRS, and don't let anybody tell you otherwise. Kiesel Aries, PRS Custom 24, Headless Strandberg Bowden. Quite cool guitars, to be fair. I don't really like them, but they're cool. I don't like playing them, because I'm enormous, and they look silly on me. It's a me problem, it's not a them problem. Hello Kitty guitar as well, nice. And a PRS SE McCarty, loads of cool guitars, right? Loads and loads and loads of cool guitars. Now, If any of you manage to play that lick upside down, here we go. John Mack says, I can't believe how difficult that is lefty style. It really is though, right? Like, it just serves to highlight the importance of physical technique in literally everything we play. Now, we might do like a G and C chord the other way up and see how difficult it is, but we've already kind of established that. We don't need to labor that point any further. So, now we've established that technique is important, let's talk about three things that you can do to improve your technique. And we're going to start with the first one. The first one is this, which is to find a technical model that works for you. Now, say works for you, because this is the interesting thing about technique, is there isn't really a one-size-fits-all approach to physical technique on the instrument. How do we know this? Right? How do we know that there isn't a one-size-fits-all physical model on the instrument? Because some people would like you to believe that there is. Some people would like you to believe that there is one and only one way to play the guitar. To which I'll respond that for every great guitar player that you find that has a certain technical model, you will find another equally great guitar player with a completely different technical model. That can be everything from preferences in terms of pick strategy, through to left hand posture, through to fretting pressure, through to where in the chain of the right hand the resistance comes in, whether it's a big grippy thumb or whether it's an open light thumb position but a heavy attack, etc. There are loads and loads and loads of ways to skin a cat when it comes to physical technique, and I'm going to encourage you to essentially try a bunch of them and explore what works for you. Now, we're going to do some picking stuff and we'll see if we can find some stuff that is easy for you to carry off. But there's a lot of other ways that we can talk about this too. We can talk about it from fretting the position. We might do a bit of that too. Now, there are some core points of performance that we have to meet as far as our technical model goes. And we might think about these as some high-level principles that our technique model has to fit. But if it fits those high-level principles, then we're good. So what might these be? Well, first of all, our technique has to meet the points of performance for playing the guitar. So it's no good if our technique feels good but doesn't actually allow us to play the things that we want to play. So what does that involve? Let's talk about the things that go into making a technique that is, I guess you could call this effective and efficient. So what you might have is you might take the idea that your technique should allow you to play clean notes that ring out without kind of being muffled or without being buzzy or being out of tune. So it should allow you to play notes that are in tune and clean and as long or as short as you want them to. You might, or as long as short as you want them to be. Now, you might also say that your technique should allow you to easily reach any of the notes that are within your reach. So what we might say with that is we might say, well, you should have a technique that would allow you, if you have a stretch, let's say, that allows you to play from fret 5 up to maybe fret 10, that's quite a big stretch, your technique should facilitate that. I'm not saying that it should allow you to play from fret 5 up to fret 17 in one position, unless you have the biggest hands in the universe. But realistically, you should be able to reach notes. Your technique shouldn't stop you from grabbing the notes that you want to grab. But beyond that, there's lots of ways we can hold our hand to make that work. Other things might be, you should be able to color a note any way that you like, with your picking, with your vibrato, with your whatever your color tools are. Ultimately, your technique should meet the points of performance when it comes to playing the guitar. So that's one thing. Another thing we have to pay attention to with this is we have to pay attention to whether our technique is repeatable. What I mean by repeatable is it shouldn't look like a completely different physical shape every time you sit down and play the guitar. So if we try playing, let's take a nice simple scale for argument's sake. Let's take the minor pentatonic scale. Let's take it in the key of A. Let's play the following frets. We're gonna play 8-5, 8-5, 7-5, 7-5, 7-5, 7-5, 8-5. Let's take a look at a few different ways we could play that. So, first thing we could do is we could play it using one finger per string, one finger per fret rather. So we use our pinky finger for the 8th fret, first finger for the 5th fret, and then third finger for the 7th fret, first finger for the 5th fret, you get the idea. Which would give us something that might look a bit like this. At speed, we might get of those look pretty similar. Now, we could also play using just finger 3 and 1. We could play using fingers 3, 1, and 2. We could play using a slightly horizontal, a slightly oblique hand position. So rather than this, we could play like this. Versus this. All of these are perfectly effective ways to play this minor pentatonic scale. But the point being with this is it should be repeatable. It should be something where every time you sit down and play, it looks about the same. About the same as every other time that you play it. You know, within reason, doesn't have to look identical. You shouldn't worry about taking a screen cap and seeing if your hand is angled like this versus like this. That's not going to make a whole amount of difference, realistically. But it should be something that is fairly repeatable. Another thing that is repeatable is it should be something that works most every time you try and play something. So your technique should be something that doesn't just work some of the time. It should be something that works the majority of the time. So if you play, for example, this lovely Paul Gilbert lick, which we all love, it should work every time you play it, as opposed to like this. So we're looking for a technique that is reliable and repeatable, meets the points of performance. One other thing we might use for our technical model is we might use the idea of technique being sustainable, being a technique that doesn't cause you great fatigue over time. So you shouldn't be using a technique that is maybe very, very tense, let's say. This is not to say that you should always play with the absolute lightest and deftest of touches, but if your technique wears you out over time, might be worth reevaluating that, because we've all had that thing where we've been on stage or maybe we've been jamming for a long time and we just feel our hands running out of steam. Now, we don't really want that. We want our technique to be something that we can play for hours and hours and hours with and have it be reliable and repeatable and efficient and effective and meet the points of performance, all that sort of stuff. But beyond that, the shape of the technical model that you use is going to be individual. Now, the way you find this is through free experimentation and embracing the things that feel good, embracing the things that feel right. Now, I did see a couple of folks over the last 6 months or so kind of lean into this idea that no, there is one way to play and you should only play this way and you shouldn't worry about what feels good to you. And some guy even tried to invoke, tried to invoke sports science for this. And I'm like, that ain't it. You've got that a bit wrong there. I do apologize, but I don't want to throw people under the bus, but you got it a bit wrong. The evidence for this is in the human outcomes that we see. We see guitar players with hugely effective techniques that look wildly different. The reasons for this are all manner of things. Preference, the instrument that you play, segment length, the length of your arm, the length of your torso, the height you prefer to wear your guitar, the length of your respective fingers, the distance between your respective fingers, how big your palm is, how tall your palm is, how thick or short or fat, where your fingers bend, how long this joint is compared to this joint, the difference in ratios between your fingers. They're all going to impact the way that you hold a pick, the way that you hold the guitar. They're all going to have a different influence on what feels particularly good to you. And ultimately, it's more about finding a technique that works than it is meeting a rigid technical model. And if anybody tries to enforce a rigid technical model on you, you are free to reject them and tell them that I said so. Not that that's going to make any difference, because they'll just go, who? But doesn't really matter. Anyway, so let's use this as an example. We're going to explore a few ways that we can play a line. And we're going to pick up the speed a little bit here and see if we can get some pacey stuff going on. Now, some of you will be able to play this line in every conceivable way. Others of you will be able to play this line in some ways, but not others. Others still might not be able to play this line at all, but that's also okay. Now, the line in question is going to be as follows. We're going to take an A minor natural minor scale, and we're going to run it from the bottom to the top, and we're going to run it from the bottom to the top with some variation in between. Let me show you the scale. We're going to both hands here. So, the scale in question is the following. We have 3, 5, 7 on the lowest three strings. 3, 5, 7, 3, 5, 7, 3, 5, 7. On the next string, we have 4, 5, 7. And then we have 5, 6, 8, 5, 7, 8. It runs as follows. We have 3, 5, 7, 3, 5, 7, 3, 5, 7, 4, 5, 7, 5, 7, 8, 5, 6, 8, 5, 7, 8. Let's play along with the backing track, nice and slow to get it under our fingers. Then we're going to explore some ways we can speed this up. So we might get this. Just so we can get some feel for what's going on here. Okay, ready? Let's try it. 2, 3, 4. Piece of cake. A little cheeky technique swap there mid-line, just to give you an idea of what's coming. Let's try it at some kind of pace. So let's try going like this. Let's go. Let me know if this is something you can play. If you can still keep up with this, let me know. So this is our eighth note triplet speed. Should be working fine, shouldn't pose too much of a problem for us. Let's try going a little faster, let's go. And a little faster again, let's go. Notice there was a little cheat there. Now we're gonna get into that. Let me know if you managed all of those or if the last one was a little bit too fast. If the last one was a little bit too fast, let me know. If it's still okay, then we are good. Now, let's get into some of the challenges here. So. First thing we're going to play, we are going to play the following lick, but we're going to play it using a doubled up 6-note pattern on each string. What's that going to mean? It's going to mean we're going to play the following. We're going to go low, middle, high, low, middle, high on each string. Same thing again. Now, if you're finding it too fast, if any of you guys are okay, then by all means, try and keep up. If you got to try and keep up, that's not a challenge. It's not me saying, hey, try and keep up with this. Far from it. But if you guys find it's a little too fast, feel free to play along at a slightly slower speed, and that's okay. Daryl Queen says, grab the last one, but had to do a bit of legato to make it work. Same. So, doubled up. First thing we're going to do is we're going to play using alternate picking. Down, up, down, up, down, up. Let's see what's going on here. So if we play along with this, let's see who can play this along with alternate picking. Let's have a go going. It's pretty quick. Let's try it together. Ready? A 1, 2, 3, 4. Pretty fast. Let's go a little slower for those of you who were struggling. Let's go like this. Let's go. One more time. Here we go. John McGuigan has a great observation. Says the doubling up is easier because the picking on strings, changing strings, stays the same. For sure. I totally agree, right? That's why we chose it. That's why I did it. So we go again. Let me know if this is something you can play. If we do it faster. We should be good. Now, anybody's having trouble with this, fear not, fear not, fear not. What we can also try is the following. We can try playing starting an upstroke and see what that gives us. So we might get this, we might get this. Oh, that's tough. What am I gonna get? I find that a bit more challenging, but let's try it together. We go. Does that work for us? Who knows? Maybe. Now, let's go back to the non-double version and see what it gives us. Let's try playing with alternate picking. Let's try going. Is it working for us? Potentially. Let's try doing it a slightly different way. Let's try doing it like this. I'm going to mute the backing track real quick. Let's try doing it with a little sweep after each pick. What you'll see there is I'm playing down, up, down, resting on the next string, down, up, down, down, up, down, down, up, down, down, up, down, down, up, down. You get the gist. Let's see if that works. This might not work for you. You might find the alternate picking thing much easier. Who knows? But it might give us this. This is an example we might call economy picking. Might work, might not. But let's try it, okay? So at our slower pace, we're gonna go. Little scuff there. We might get this with alternate picking. With economy. What about one more approach? What about if we play pick, pick, and then a hammer on? Mika says, alternate picking hard, economy picking works fine. Sweet. Is there anybody who's finding the opposite is true, where economy picking is difficult, but alternate picking is fine? Let's find out in the comments. We're going to go a little faster now. Let's try going. There's our alternate picking line. Let's try economy picking. We go. Alternate picking. Let's go faster. Let's go. That's quite tough. There's economy picking. Let's try alternate picking. Oh, that's difficult. That's tough. It's there, but it's there, not quite. Now, the reason I've done this exhaustive demonstration with these two licks is to highlight to you guys that there are many, many, many ways that you can skin a cat with your technical work. Now, this is to encourage you to embrace a unique technical model that fits what feels comfortable to you and meets the points of performance, that you want to meet, which ultimately in this case is play lines with pick. Make sense? In time, in tune, the notes you want to play, in the places you want to play them, for the durations you want to play them, with the tone you want to play them. And if you have a technique that works for that, you got it. It's laughing. You don't need to go any further. Don't feel compelled to do one technical model that someone may try and impose upon you. Find one that just allows you to play the things that you want to play. And the best way to do this is through discovery. And if you want a bit of help discovering what's going on, we have a course on that subject that I'll show you in a second. And notice at no point do we discuss things like you must hold your pick like this, or 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 like this. We haven't talked about any of that stuff because you can find examples of players who use all of those and they all sound pretty damn good. Now, if you want a little bit of help with your picking in particular, with the technical model for picking, we have a course that is now available on licklibrary.com. It is part of your GI Plus selection of courses that's now available on Lick Library. It is called Picking Strategies. Part one by yours truly. When we come back from this little trailer, I'm going to show you tip number two. Does your picking feel uncoordinated and sometimes you miss notes or fluff transitions from string to string, maybe a little bit like this? When in reality, what you want is smooth and easy and transparent feeling picking, a bit like this. Or maybe you've been sold on the idea that there's one specific way that you have to pick on the guitar and everything else is wrong, but that particular cookie cutter approach just doesn't work for you. It feels unnatural. It almost feels like you're fighting your own body to try and make it work. Well, Picking Strategies Part 1 is the course for you.
In this course, we explore the many different ways that you can form a full and complete and comprehensive picking approach by examining the various strategies used by some of the greatest pickers of all time. And there are a whole bunch of strategies out there, and I guarantee there is one that is going to work for your preferred picking mechanics, the way you prefer to stand or sit with the guitar, the type of guitar you play, the type of music you play. There is a strategy for you. We're going to explore all of them, and I'm going to show you how you can take a single solo study and play every line within it using all of the six picking strategies that we look at in this course. And of course, this entire course is available as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you're not signed up already, what better excuse do you need to sign up today? There you go, guys. That's Picking Strategies Part 1, available now on licklibrary.com. After this video, go find it. We got some questions that have come in over the little break. We'll be answering your questions later on in this stream, and I will make up the time that we lost because the microphone was off. As Sacred Godslayer rightly pointed out, we'll go into extra time today for injury. I think Nick might have rockets in his fingers. Well, that's very kind of you. But honestly, found some technical models that work, and there we go. We've got some examples of some folks that that have examples of these technical models working here. New Roses Artworks says usually alternate ascending and economy descending, which I'm sure works really well. Sacred Godslayer says economy at the highest speed doesn't work for me. Alternate is effortless at max speed, starting both downstroke and upstroke. You know, there are ways that you can make this work for all manner of physical techniques, and this doesn't just extend to the fast stuff, it extends to all the other things that come to play in the guitar. Now, here is tip number two, or tool number two. Tip number one is find a technical model that works for you. This is number two, which is measure and track. Now, what are we talking about when we talk about measure and track? Well, measure and track essentially is, it's one of the things that we need to do to make progress in any physical endeavor, is we need to assess that we're making progress and provide enough stimulus to encourage that progress, and that must get harder over time. Anybody who's a bit of a gym rat will know exactly what I'm talking about here. So we'll not get too deep into the lifting analogies, but it's kind of on my mind right now, hitting some PRs in preparation for powerlifting meet, and it's feeling good, but we'll talk about that another time. So in terms of measurement, in terms of tracking, we can do the following. The first thing we can do is we can measure if our technique is working. How do we do that? Well, we listen and we assess. A few ways you can do this. You can use a looper pedal. You can play your technique into a looper pedal. You can use video review. So you can play some things and record it and then play it again maybe next week and record it. We're measuring whether our technique is meeting the points of performance. We can also do subjective assessments. We can assess whether our technique feels more sustainable, whether it feels more repeatable than it was, or whether it feels less repeatable. So measuring whether our technique is efficient and effective is very important. But in terms of tracking our progress, this is usually best done, in far as technique goes, with a metronome. So we've all done the metronome chasing thing, I'm sure. If you haven't, hey, you're in for a bumpy ride, let's just say that. But metronomes can take the form of metronomes, or they can take the form of drum loops. I like drum loops, personally, because you can dance to a drum loop. Metronomes, they'll break your heart. But anyway, what we might do is we might take that Paul Gilbert exercise that we've talked about so many times. In fact, we've done that loads. Let's not do that. Let's do the exercise that we were just playing, which is this doubled up. What we might do is we might assess our ability to play this at a particular tempo. That would be 16 triplets at 100 BPM. If you can play it at 100 BPM, and then a couple of weeks later you can play it at 120 like this, you know that you have gotten objectively better. Now,
There is a subjective component to this as well. Subjective component to this too. We track our progress, but we must make a note not only of our ability to play things at different speeds, but we must also make subjective assessments as to how difficult things are. So here's the thing. Let's say that you sit down to play something at, say, 100 BPM one day, and it feels pretty easy. And then the next day, you sit down and you play at 110 BPM, and it feels like you get it, but it's at the very limit of your abilities, right? The very limit of your abilities. Have you gotten any faster? Have you gotten any better? We don't know. The reason for this is the difficulty is not being held constant. So what we should be looking for is a difficulty that we can repeat. And usually what that means is something that requires you to concentrate and really put some effort forth, but isn't ever really in much danger of coming apart. So if you practice at a constant subjective difficulty and you track your ability to increase speed over time, then you know for a fact that you're getting a little bit better. So measure and track your progress, which leads me to point number three. It's quite a short one, that one, because it speaks for itself. Point number three is a very important one, which is variation. Now, tracking progress is fair. It's good, right? We like tracking progress. Variation is one of these concepts that is not discussed enough when it comes to practicing. We tend to practice the same things over and over again. The same things over and over again. You might play maybe that Paul Gilbert lick or that six note a string kind of like sort of scale phrase that we just played. You might try that. You might try whatever it is that you're practicing, whatever it is you're playing. You may wind up playing the same thing over and over and over and over again. And that's cool. That's fine. But here's the deal. The human body does, or the human mind, body, whatever it is, humans learn not just by repetition, but they learn by solving problems. We learn more through close variation than we do from straight repetition. Now, this doesn't mean that we vary things every time we play a lick, we vary it, but it means we have to reduce variation over time. What does this look like? Well, close variation would be an example of something like this. If we take the same scale lick that we just played, this six notes scale lick, this business of playing here, we're at 120, let's keep things there, but we'll slow it down a little bit. So if we had this lick, a close variation would maybe be to try and play, instead of low, middle, high, we might play high, middle, low each time. So we might get this, we might get. Now, as an experiment, let's try that. Let's try playing. I'm gonna get rid of the delay because it's a bit over the top right now. Let's try doing, I'll try get rid of the delay full stop. Let's try playing the same thing that we did before, which is low, middle, high. We should probably be quite well adapted to that now. Let's try going. Now, even for you skilled guitar players out there, we're gonna try playing high, middle, low, high, middle, low. Same thing. Ascending across the strings, you should feel something when we do this. You should be aware of a feeling of, ooh, that's new, right? Be aware of that and pay attention to it. Let's try it together, ready? So we're gonna play. Ready? Two, three, four. That should have felt to you like there was a weird unfamiliarity under the fingers. Even if you played this lick loads, you should feel this, ooh, that's kind of weird and new. The reason for this is it's a variation on this exercise that we've been playing for the last 20 minutes or so, right? We spent quite a bit of time with this six notes up thing. Our brain and our fingers are quite well adapted to this. But by imposing a slight variation on what we're playing, we give the brain an opportunity to solve the problem of playing the guitar all over again. Now, in terms of solving the problem, what this means is your brain is constantly figuring out how to move your fingers in a way that meets the points of performance that we want. And the more opportunities we give it to solve these problems, the more we present it with new and interesting problems, the better it gets at doing the thing we want to do. It's been demonstrated time and time again in both practice, in skill disciplines like playing music, and also in sports science. Let's say, for example, throwing the discus, or running the 100-meter hurdles, or whatever, pole vaulting, playing whatever variation of football is popular in your native country. Or the lowest skill sport in the world, which is the one I do, which is powerlifting. Even still, it's been demonstrated time and time again that we get better at our core skill faster if we practice the core skill and close variations than if we only practice the core skill. This has been studied at length, and we can apply this to our guitar playing. So variations include things like varying rhythm, changing the order of notes in the lick, varying the equipment that we play it on, such as playing on different guitars. If you have a Strat and a Les Paul, let's say, they have different scale lengths. So playing the same lick on a couple of different guitars presents a variation. Playing the lick on an acoustic guitar, playing the lick with a different kind of plectrum or no plectrum at all presents a variation. Now this can also work on things that aren't just exercises. Let's say we go back to our original lick demonstration. What about if we try varying this all sorts of different ways? We'll go back to our backing track. Let's get rid of the drums and let's have our A minor ballad backing track again. Let me show you a bunch of different ways that we can vary this from a technical perspective. So first things first, let's go to the two hands so you can see what's going on. I'm going to try and play, and you're welcome to do these as well, by the way. So we play. We're going to vary it by playing it without a pick. I'm going to play it with my thumb and fingers. I'm going to play it with only my thumb. I'm going to play using only upstrokes. Only downstrokes. Playing very quietly. Playing very loud. Playing with the last two notes in the wrong order. Changing the positions of the notes. Changing the fingers I'm playing with. All of these present technical variations on a single lick that we can use to develop our ability to play not just that lick, but all sorts of other things without having to go mad in the shred world. And of course, that's just playing the same lick. What you might also do is you might learn a bunch of licks or learn a bunch of solos, let's say, that are close to the ones that you're already playing. And a great way to do this is to explore the vocabulary of one guitar player in particular. Because you tend to find that guitar players, let's say, for example, you're really into Angus Young, for argument's sake. You'll find that there is a similar vocabulary to a lot of Angus's playing. And if you learn more of his lines, rather than, let's say, you just wanted to learn the solo from Thunderstruck, well, what if you also decided to learn the solo from Back in Black, and you decided to learn the solo from Shook Me All Night Long, and decided to learn the solo from wherever? Lick Library is a great place to go and get this, by the way, because we have a huge variety of songs available, including classic albums, start to finish, note for note tuition, face to face as well. It's not just tab, it's the whole teaching experience. It's way better. If you want any help choosing this stuff, we also do one-to-one support, but that's the sales pitch. We don't need to talk about that. But variation is super, super important for this because it presents us with these time to solve the problem moments again. And that, dear friends, is where the real gold is, right? That's where the real, real, real good stuff comes from. So Daryl Queen says, I've heard this referred to as muscle confusion exercises. Yeah, you know, you can probably think about it like that. That's some Arnold stuff right there. You've got to shock the muscle. But for example, here is another way we might look at it. So if we look at the way, I'm trying to think of things that I actually know about. I'm not much of a sportsman, but if we take strength sports, which I do participate in, if, let's say, for example, I was coaching someone to have a more efficient bench press. Let's use the bench press, right? And let's say, for example, they were struggling to get the bar from, this is probably going to be boring if you guys don't lift weights, but most people do bench press if they do lift weights. Let's say someone was struggling to get the bar from chest back over their shoulders to lockout, right? Let's say they were struggling with that. I could try and enforce some kind of technical cue that would be like, oh, well, flare your elbows when you get off the chest, for example. Or I could program variations, like, say, for example, a pin bench press or an incline bench press that would challenge their ability to perform that movement. And in doing so, they'll actually get better at the core skill quicker. So this is kind of where this comes from. Another example of this might be things like agility drills that you see ball sports athletes doing, if that makes sense. Here's a really cool comment from Boomster Black saying, John Bjork has a cool approach about looping the exercises by taking the sequence and starting it from different points. Very, very cool. That is a really, really great observation. So the three things that we are looking at here, with some very kind comments coming in, but yeah, the three things that we're talking about here are the following. I'm going to encourage you to, A, number one, find a technical model that works for you. Discover a technical model that works for you. Measure and track your progress, and embrace variation in your practice. Don't practice the same things over and over again. This is not the Bruce Lee business of, you know, what is it like, don't be a man who knows 1,000 kicks, be a man that's practiced one kick 1,000 times or something. It's not what we're looking for here. It's a cool soundbite, right? Cool soundbite. And maybe for the kick, it's a cool thing, but for the guitar, we want variation in our practice. So here's a cool one from Mike. Mike says, I've never heard this micro change approach before. I will be incorporating. You totally should, man. And it can be as simple as picking up another guitar or grabbing another pick. Here's another one, right? I'm gonna take the same deal. Take a look at this pick here, right? This is a terrible pick. Not because it's badly made. It's by our friends at Ernie Ball. They make lovely picks, but it is really, really thin. This is, I think, a 0.6 millimeter. And it's also massive. And for me, I'm more of a jazz pick kind of guy. But watch this, right? I'm gonna play a line and I'm gonna incorporate a change of plectrum, right? If you have two picks available, you should try this, right? So same backing track, watch this. If I play, change the pick. Oh, it sounds good. It sounds really good. Let's change the pick to a different material. Let's go back to the original. And away we go. So that provides a variation in and of itself. Just grab a different pick. Grab a different pick. So anyway, we got some questions coming in. If you have questions, we have answers. We'll be extending the Q&A session today because, of course, I did manage to switch my mic off for an extended period of time at the start of the stream. So we'll keep going. We're going to get some more questions on the go. And we've got a few good ones coming in. I really, really want to highlight this one. I hope I've started. If I haven't, I'm going to go searching for it. It's my friend, Victor Zika. I'm going to find this comment. Now, unfortunately, it's not starred up right now, but it is a great question, a very good question about injury. And we're going to address that as we go, a finger injury in particular. Let me just go find the guy. If you do have questions, by the way, drop your questions down below because we're going to answer as many of them as we can. Now, let's just keep on going. While we're here, PSE is asking if there will be another 51 Rock Licks DVD. Maybe there will be. Maybe we'll do 52. Who knows? But yeah, for you guys wondering, that is one of the courses that I have that's available on licklibrary.com. It is 51 over the top Rock Licks. If you want some really, really silly licks that you'll get fired from your band for playing, but they are good fun, try to get some nuggets of information in there. There's actually a concept that's being explained in the whole thing. It's not just licks. But yeah, go to licklibrary.com, go grab it. Here's a question from Victor Zika. Okay. I have broken my left ring finger. I am really sorry to hear that. I'm cringing in pain thinking about it, but I'm sorry to hear that, man. Actually, no loads, because had problems with fingers before. Still plenty of things to practice, like finger picking, etc. Calling that the crippled finger challenge. It really sucks that you're injured, man. I'm sorry to hear that, but finger breaks, they're gross. They're no fun. And it takes you out of the game. It's not a wonderful position to be. But you're absolutely right. You're embracing things. And this is something we can all learn from. Embracing things that we can do. So rather than looking at all the things that you can't do and go, oh, okay, well, you might as well not bother playing the guitar, embrace the things that you can. So for example, grab a slide. Time to get really good at playing Pinky Finger Slide. If you can, if it doesn't hurt to do Pinky Finger Slide, or get really, really, really good at tapping with just your right hand and playing melodies with just this. Find ways of playing your favorite solos using just right hand tapping, for example. Finger picking is really great. You can explore, you can take this opportunity to practice your harmonics. You can practice playing lines with one finger, so you can practice your phrasing. Harder than it looks. But hey, it presents us with a challenge, and you're doing the right thing by embracing the things that you can do rather than worrying too much about the things that you can't do. I have a friend, I keep going back to powerlifting, but I have a friend who hurt their back very recently. It was about 6 months ago, just gotten into the sport, and was given a very overzealous program by a well-meaning coach, and it was just too much stuff, too much volume, and they hurt the back. So the way we framed it was, you know what, yes, deadlifts and squats are going to be a problem right now. It's time to PR your bench press, because we have all these resources that we can put into the stuff that we can do rather than focusing too hard on the stuff that we can't. So very inspiring stuff, man. Thank you for sharing that with us. I really do appreciate that. So we got some other great questions coming in. Going to highlight some of these as we go. Mal Riley is saying, do you keep your finger number one down while while the 3 and 5 frets are played, referring to, I guess what you mean is finger number one, do you keep that down while we play with finger two and finger four? As a rule, we try not to do that. So we try and just have the fingers down that we need for the notes we're playing at any given point. The reason for this is, if you have a finger down at any point and you try and move your other fingers, stuff gets a bit weird. Let me show you an example of this, right? Let's try doing this as a little exercise. Let's try playing something with our first and third fingers. Let's try playing the middle notes of our A minor pentatonic scale. It's gonna be 7-5-7-5 on the D string, G string. G string, then D string. Next thing I want to do is I want you to put your second finger down on fret 6 on the B string and just keep it there. Hold it down, and then let's try playing the same thing. Hopefully you'll be feeling what I'm feeling there, that is more challenging. This is actually a skill all unto itself. And if you're a classical guitar player, you need to be able to do this. You need to be able to hold one note and move your other fingers independently of each other. But as a rule, when we can get away with not doing that, we should. And that means when we're playing scale lines, we try where possible to not have the fingers that we're not using down on the string at any given point. So that's the thing with that. Here's one from our friend, Mika, is it Siljander or Siljander? I will say, I'm assuming it's Siljander, but I apologize. I butcher everyone's names. I do apologize for that. So Mika is asking, I've always struggled to pick 3 note per string scales from high E to low E string. Any strategy for playing the same example, G mix leading scale, we just picked from the low E. So from high E to low E. There's a few ways you can do this. So I'm going to give you the cliff notes on the picking strategies thing really quickly. But here's the deal. So when we are picking, usually the challenge is not just moving the pick back and forward in the string. It's not picking on the string that is the issue, right? The issue is changing strings. And that's normally where we start to get tripped up. So what people will try and do is what we play at slower speeds. When we play at slower speeds, we can get away with getting the pick out of the strings on every pick stroke. What I mean by that is after every pick stroke, the pick escapes the strings and is ready to find another string anew. That's fine at slower speeds, but when things start to speed up, that starts to break down. What we end up doing instead is we should be looking for the pick to move in a straight line. Now, this is difficult because, first of all, the human body doesn't move in straight lines. It moves in circles. Circles this way, circles this way, but even still, broadly speaking, a straight line. A line that is straight enough that, you know, or a circle that is broad enough
that it feels straight. Now, if you do this, what you'll notice is it's impossible to change from string to string because the pick just kind of catches on the string. So what we do instead is we take this straight line and we angle the straight line. Let me use this pick so you can see very clearly. We angle the pick. We angle the path of the pick's travel. It's still straight, but instead of being straight like this, it's now straight like this or like this. They're still straight lines, right? We angle it so that the stroke we want to finish our string on moves away from the guitar's body. And the stroke we don't want to finish our string on moves in towards the guitar's body. How far you do this is kind of up to you, but the way that you do it is very simple. If we want a downstroke to escape, let's do this together, right? Real quick. Take finger number one, place it on fret number five on the E string. Pick up and down like this in a straight movement. As we do this, I want you to become aware of the two bones that are in your forearm. You've got two of them. You should feel a fairly even distribution of weight onto the guitar's body across both bones. Lean your hand so that the thumb side bone, this bone here, is the one that's in contact with the guitar's body. Now lean your hand so that the other bone is the one that's in contact with the guitar's body, the pinky side bone. Get used to doing that while maintaining this tremolo picking movement. Now, with this side touching the guitar's body, notice how the pick is now angled in such a way that the pick moves away from the guitar's body after a downstroke. That's how we get that to work. If we want to finish a line in a downstroke, we lean this way. If we want the opposite to happen, we want to finish a string on an upstroke, we lean the other way. We get this bone in contact with the guitar's body, give or take. That's how escape strokes work. We don't have to escape. We don't have to do escape strokes. What we can do is we can do this. We can play. With a little miniature sweep. A sweep of one string that we might call economy picking. We can use some blend of alternate and economy picking, depending upon what feels most comfortable to us. If this posture just feels weird and you don't like it, don't sweat it. Downstroke escape when you can, upstroke and sweep when you must. Same is true if this feels weird, but this feels good. Upstroke escape when you can, downstroke and escape when you must. There are players of great players that use all manner of these strategies. And you can find examples of all of them being used successfully if you look hard enough. Troy Grady has some fantastic resources on this. He kind of brought all this stuff to light. Very, very cool. Hopefully, that should help with the questions. Good question, though. Very cool question. Here is a good one from good comment from Cowcat saying, I use tool variation nowadays by means of using a totally different kind of pick to what I use normally. For sure. You can do the same with tone. You can do the same with guitars. So if I get a bit comfy on this, I might grab this Godan, for example. This Godan is tuned B to B and is a different scale length to this guitar. By contrast, I might grab this for a laugh, Rapier 12 string, which is super cool. One of the ugliest guitars I've ever seen, but it's kind of cool. Great guitar. I might play on this for some kind of variation. I'll also hit my other guitar with it. So varying the guitars that you play can also work as a tool variation. It's very cool. Very, very cool. So guys, unfortunately, I think we've run out of time. I do want to take a quick second and shout out my dear friend Sam Bell, who's joined us. Sam, you can check out on licklibrary.com. So many lessons. Sam is not just a great guitar player and a great teacher, but a great thinker on the guitar. He has some fantastic insights on not just the instrument, but also life
and existing as a guitar player, just go check out Sam's lessons. Go and follow him on social. He is the best, but more importantly, a great dude. Lovely guy. All the time in the universe for Sam. He's great. So here's one from Mustache Metal. We might as well get through this too. I can blaze through alternate picking runs with inside string changes, but not for very long. Relaxing the forearm muscles is the tricky part of me and still having stamina left in the tank. Any tips? Yes. So what you might be doing, maybe, this could be, you know, might not be it, but what I think it might be, is I would assess where the slack in the pick setup is. The slack in the pick setup. What I mean by this is the slack in the setup. Something has to give in order for us to get the pick from this side of the string to the other. And here are the things that can give. We can make the string give. We can move the string until it will move no more and flops under the pick and pops out the other side. We can have give in the pick, so the pick flops over the string by holding the pick lightly. We can have give in our fingers by using a tight pick grip in this sense, but having our fingers be quite loose up here. It's quite tough to achieve, but we can have some give in the finger. We can have the fingers be snug and firm, but have a bit give in the pick. We can have give in the string. I would encourage you to assess where the give is coming from and see if it's resulting too much from the string giving. So if we're picking really, really hard and we play, where we absolutely batter on the guitar, that can work for a period of time, but because we're forcing our way through the string, it can be a little fatiguing because all of the muscles in the forearm have to work very, very hard just to keep that happening. Now, if we embrace a slightly lighter pick grip, and we can still pick pretty hard, we can still get a lot of force into the string, we maintain a slightly lighter pick grip. Let me do it with, do I have a pick that's very visible? Maybe this yellow one, who knows? That might be fun. Hopefully, nope, that's still super invisible, but even still, I'll try it with the floppy pick. That's another place it can give. If the pick has some give in it itself, it can do the thing. But if we hold the pick lightly, we can still get some speed up, but the pick is just giving, and that's where the slack in the setup is coming from. We want to find that slack, and we want to make sure that the slack is not necessarily always coming from just bashing through the string and moving the string out of the way. We want a little bit of give in our pick setup too. How much? Experiment with it. Find the amount that feels good and is sustainable. So sustainable meets the points of performance, etc., etc., etc. So anyway, guys, thank you so much. My name is Nick Jennison. It has been a blast. Once again, this is the Monday Guitar Show. I just want to remind you that we do this every Monday at 8 p.m. UK time. It's always fun to hang out with you guys and shoot the proverbial about all things guitar related. We're back next week with another stream and we're talking about practice. Next week, we're talking about optimizing your practice sessions for the most progress. Make sure you don't miss that. If you want to be informed of when we're about to go live, hit the subscribe bell on whatever channel you happen to be watching on. We are going simultaneously on the Guitar Interactive and the Lick Library YouTube channels. Make sure you hit the bell icon too, so we can let you know when we are about to go live. It's Mondays, 8 p.m. UK time. Set yourself a reminder or subscribe and hit the bell so we can give you one. While you're there, give this video a thumbs up, share it with your guitar playing friends, and don't forget, check out licklibrary.com for the best guitar lessons that you're ever going to find, including all of the GI Plus lessons that are live now on licklibrary.com. And also, don't forget to head to guitarinteractivemagazine.com for everything else, which is interviews, reviews, news, all of the good stuff that we love about gear, about artists that we love. That's all available on guitarinteractivemagazine.com. Give us a subscribe while you're there. My name's Nick Jennison. I will see you next week, Monday, 8 p.m. UK time. Let's play out on the backing track that we've been playing on, and let's see if the amp is going to play or if I'm going to stick. I'm kind of digging this channel 1 sound, but I really feel like I want channel 2. Is it going to scream at me? It's screaming at me. So we'll stick with this one. That's fine. We can live with that. Yep, it's working now. So, oh no. We'll be right back.
Hi, my name's Nick Jennison, and it's my pleasure to announce that GI Plus, the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine, is moving to licklibrary.com. GI Plus features a whole host of the best players and educators in the world, bringing you exclusive lessons on everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful. Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Members also get access to every lesson ever published in Guitar Interactive magazine, including Michael Caswell's legendary Pro Concepts column. Or maybe you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 70 full-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. And you get all of this in addition to all of the amazing content on licklibrary.com, which includes note-for-note tuition of over 60 classic albums, weekly lesson uploads, a backing track library, and one-to-one player support. There has never been a better time to sign up than right now.